Hi, my name is Chris and this is Battle Nonsense. Today's video was not sponsored by AMD, NVIDIA or any other company. It was made possible by the support of my awesome patrons. Now with that out of the way, let's talk about input lag. I think that most players know that games feel more responsive at high frame rates and less responsive at lower frame rates. So if you want to decrease the input lag, you must increase the frame rate and maybe invest in a higher refresh rate monitor. But what if you just cannot get your PC to run games at a higher frame rate? To reduce the input lag in such a situation, AMD offers a feature called anti-lag, and NVIDIA provides an ultra-low latency mode. So let's take a look at what AMD has to say about anti-lag. It helps to reduce input lag in GPU-limited cases, and it can shrink input lag by almost a full frame. This means that when a game runs at 60 FPS, anti-lag can reduce the input lag by up to 16 milliseconds. At 120 FPS, it's about 8 milliseconds, and so on. Anti-lag requires at least an HD 7700 graphics card and works in games which use either DirectX 11 or DirectX 9. However, to use anti-lag in DirectX 9 games, you need at least an RX 5700. Now let's take a look at what NVIDIA has to say about their low latency modes. As many of you will know, NVIDIA had a maximum pre-rendered frame setting inside the control panel for over a decade, which allowed gamers to set how many frames get buffered in the render queue. Here it is important to know that a smaller buffer means less delay. In the current driver, this feature was renamed to low latency. Off means that the game engine decides how many frames to buffer. On limits the number of queued frames to 1, and Ultra sends the frame just in time for the graphics card to pick it up and render it. Just like anti-lag, the low latency modes have the most impact when your game is GPU bound, so when your graphics card is maxed out. It also only works with games that use either DirectX 9 or DirectX 11, but it is not limited to a specific series of GeForce graphic cards. In terms of ease of use, anti-lag is more convenient, as you can enable it inside the overlay that you can bring up with the shortcut Alt and R, while you can only switch between the low latency modes inside the NVIDIA control panel. So both AMD's anti-lag and NVIDIA's ultra-low latency mode are meant to reduce input lag when your graphics card is completely maxed out. But how do you know if that is the case? To check the GPU load while gaming, you can simply install MSI Afterburner, which provides a fully customizable in-game overlay. In this example here, you can see that my graphics card is completely maxed out, and so my frame rate is limited by the performance of my graphics card. This is a situation where both anti-lag and ultra-low latency can further reduce the input lag, and so make the game more responsive. If you would see less than 99%, then you are not limited by the power of your graphics card, and so neither anti-lag nor ultra-low latency will help. This can be the case when VSync locks your frame rate at the refresh rate of the monitor, or when you use an FPS limiter to achieve stable frame times or to keep the frame rate inside the variable refresh rate range of your FreeSync or G-Sync monitor. But it is also possible that you are CPU limited, which means that your CPU is so slow that it is bottlenecking your system and so does not allow the graphics card to unfold its full potential. I don't want to go too deep into the subject in today's video, but please know that when you have a CPU with 4 or more cores, then the combined CPU utilization value of all cores does not tell you anything. To find out if you are indeed CPU limited, you must keep an eye on the CPU load of each individual core. But all that you have to know for now is that if your GPU load does not reach or exceed 97%, then you are not limited by the performance of your graphics card, and so neither anti-lag nor ultra-low latency will help. So now you know as much as I did when I began to test these features. I thought that this would be a relatively simple and straightforward test, which should only take a few hours. But little did I know, as these tests revealed something that, in my opinion at least, is far more interesting and maybe even more important to gamers than these features. But first, how do I even test how responsive a game feels? What I'm interested in is the end-to-end delay that every player is affected by, which means the delay between the input, like pressing the left mouse button, and the gunfire showing up on the monitor. To measure that button-to-pixel delay, I use a high-speed camera and a gaming mouse which has an LED connected directly to the switch of the left mouse button. I then point the high-speed camera at the monitor and record what happens when I press the left mouse button. Inside the recorded high-speed footage, I then look for the frame where the LED turns on, and then I count the frames until I see the action triggered by that input, which gives me the delay between the button and the pixel. So the results that I'm going to show you are the delays that you would experience when playing on that hardware. For my first tests, I used Overwatch at 1080p, 144Hz, with the Epic graphics preset and a render resolution of 200% to put some stress on the RX 5700 and the GTX 1080. I also disabled the reduce buffering setting inside Overwatch to be sure that it does not interfere with anti-lag and the ultra-low latency mode. So, with the graphics card completely maxed out at 99%, Overwatch ran at 85fps on the RX 5700 and 81fps on the GTX 1080. Under these conditions, I measured an average button-to-pixel delay of 71.33 milliseconds on the RX 5700 and 72 milliseconds on the GTX 1080. Then I enabled anti-lag, which reduced the average input delay by nearly 9 milliseconds, which is a bit less than one frame at 84 frames per second. With ultra-low latency enabled, I measured about 10 milliseconds less delay, which is also a bit less than one frame at 81 frames per second. So, both anti-lag and ultra-low latency do exactly what AMD and NVIDIA promise. They slightly reduce the input lag in situations where you are limited by the power of your graphics card. Then I wondered what would happen when I kept the frame rate at 60 inside Overwatch. Once I did that, the GPU load dropped to less than 79% on the RX 5700, and the input lag was reduced significantly by 24 milliseconds, despite Overwatch now running at 25 frames per second less. The same occurred with the GTX 1080 and ultra-low latency enabled. This was strange, because both these features should only help when the GPU is maxed out. So I disabled anti-lag and tested again, which then reduced the input lag even further. Compared to the first test, I now measured 30 milliseconds less input lag. That's a reduction of 42% compared to running the game at 99% GPU utilization without anti-lag. And that's despite the fact that the game now ran at 60 instead of 85fps. Then I ran the same test with the GTX 1080 and low latency disabled, which showed the exact same behavior. So, what you can see here is that when your graphics card is completely maxed out, both anti-lag and ultra-low latency will slightly reduce the input lag as advertised. However, if you just ensure that your GPU does not run at 99% load, then you can reduce the input lag significantly, much more than both anti-lag and ultra-low latency do. However, you reduce your frame rate in the process, which can cause that games look less smooth. Also, when you are not GPU limited, like when you use an FPS limiter, and then enable anti-lag or ultra-low latency, then they can cause an input lag increase, as you can see when you compare the results of these tests here. Now, I don't blame you if you don't believe these results, because I did not believe them at first either. So I repeated them many times to be sure that they are accurate. I also did a few additional tests with weaker graphic cards, like GTX 1050 and RX 580. I ran the tests with a render scale of 100% and with different graphic settings. But throughout all these tests, the input lag still increased significantly as soon as the GPU hit a load of 99%. So at this point, I was more interested in that than the anti-lag feature and the ultra-low latency mode, as my tests already confirmed that these work as advertised. Then I tried to find out at which GPU load that input lag increase occurs exactly. So I set the frame rate limiter to 78 inside Overwatch, which kept the GPU load below 98%. In that scenario, I still measured slightly more delay compared to when I had the frame rate limit set to 60, but it was still significantly lower than when the graphics card was maxed out. Then I tried to find out if that also happens at higher frame rates. At this point, I decided to continue testing just with the GTX 1080, as I had that installed in the PC, and it was clear to me that this behavior is neither AMD nor NVIDIA specific. So I reduced the render scale to 150%, which brought the frame rate up to 145. At a GPU load of 99%, I then measured an average button to pixel delay of 48.2 milliseconds. When I then set the frame rate limiter inside Overwatch to 138, the GPU load dropped to less than 95%, and the input lag decreased by 14 milliseconds or 2 frames at 138 frames per second. Now I had to find out if that is an Overwatch issue. So I ran the same tests again in PUBG. At 100 FPS and a GPU load of 99%, I measured an average button to pixel delay of 43.27 milliseconds. With the built-in FPS limiter set to 90, the GPU load dropped to less than 95%, and I measured 11 milliseconds less input delay, despite the game now running at a lower frame rate. Then I switched over to Battlefield 5. At 99% GPU load and 84 FPS, I measured an average input delay of 65.2 milliseconds. With the built-in frame rate limiter set to 79 and the GPU load at less than 97%, the input delay dropped by 22 milliseconds despite the lower frame rate. I then also did a test with Battlefield 5's future frame rendering feature disabled, which on its own caused the frame rate to drop to 72 FPS and the GPU load to stay below 82%. That reduced the input delay by about 6 milliseconds, which means that future frame rendering provides a similar input lag reduction as anti-lag and the ultra-low latency mode. Earlier this week, I sent my results to my contacts at AMD and NVIDIA, so they know about my findings that reducing the GPU load leads to a significant input lag decrease. I will let you know if I hear back from them about what causes this and if something can be done about that. So now it's time to draw a conclusion. Both AMD's anti-lag and NVIDIA's ultra-low latency mode do what they are supposed to do. They slightly reduce the input delay in situations where your graphics card is maxed out. But as my results show, that difference is not that game-changing as some of the marketing and other YouTubers might have led you to believe. So, should you use these features? Well, when your graphics card is completely maxed out, then both features help and won't do any harm. But make sure that you are actually GPU bound, as these features can otherwise have a negative impact on the input lag as I've shown. So if you want to reduce the input lag while running games at an uncapped frame rate, then I encourage you to give them a try. However, you should also consider that your gaming experience isn't just about the maximum peak frame rate that your PC can achieve. In the use case where anti-lag and the ultra-low latency mode are effective, you do not only face an unstable frame rate, you also have to deal with inconsistent frame times, which means that the input lag that you are subjected to is constantly changing, as the frame rate will go up and down depending on what is happening in the game that you are playing. If you are interested in a smooth gaming experience, where you always have the same amount of input lag, which is important to build up muscle memory in competitive games, then you must limit your frame rate to a value that your PC can always maintain. So, if that sounds interesting to you, then I highly recommend that you watch the video that I made about that topic a while ago, where I show you how to get perfectly stable frame times and so consistent input lag. Which also comes with the additional bonus that your graphics card won't be maxed out all the time, which means less noise, less heat, and as we now know, less input lag. You can find a link to that video in the description down below. And that's all for today. Big shout out to my patrons, as their support allows me to create videos like this one. If you enjoy my content and would like to support my upcoming projects like a netcode analysis for Call of Duty Modern Warfare, then you can find a link to my Patreon page in the description down below, where you will also find links to my social accounts in case that you want to stay up to date on the videos that I'm working on. So if you enjoyed this video, then please give it a like, subscribe for more, and I hope to see you next time. Until then, have a nice day and take care. My name is Chris, and this was Battle Nonsense.